silence in between what I thought and what I said. You are the nighttime fear. You are the morning when it's clear. When it's over, you're the start. You're my head. No!
Really little kid, I wanted to be in musicals, and I thought I wanted to be on Broadway, and I loved musicals, but I kind of already, there was just something too spooky about my voice for the musicals. Like at school, like I think there was something too odd about, and I was in the chorus or a lot of musicals at school, but yeah, I think it is, my voice is kind of just like a vehicle for me to sort of express feelings that almost perhaps the words aren't even quite there yet. You know, I don't even know what I would want to say, but if you sing them, a mundane word can have this weight to it.
I think the songs that first started affecting me were probably, listening to Billie Holiday and a lot of Etta James and Nina Simone, but my dad was a big fan of like the Velvet Underground as well, and Love, I think Anne Moore again was one of his favourite songs, and the Incredible String Band, and I think we listened to a lot of the Rhythmics as well, Annie Lennox, and I went through a real sort of grunge phase too, so I don't know, I was kind of always interested in everything. I just love playing the drums, and I used to, well, when it was just in the many formations that this band has had, when it was just me, a guitarist, I used to, if there was a drum kit available on the stage, I would just get behind it, and you know, we'd never brought our own, we just used what was available. I think one time we used a bin and a broom. It was not that successful. I've worked with the same group of people since the very beginning, and my friends Tabitha Denholm, Tom Beard. We've worked together really closely. I mean, me and Tom met when we were 17 at Secret Garden Festival. And I think, I can't remember, I was wearing some sort of stolen fancy dress, pink fancy dress costume. Like, sort of, he kind of found me drifting by some lake and ended up taking some pictures of me.
Original studio.
Oh, look!
It's got all my records.
Look, this is where the name came from originally. It's from a drawing I did.
Oh, look! Florence The Robot is a Machine.
And yet no spaceman anymore.
we did those as well on the same day.
The Commandments.
Florence Commandments. Always proceed.
Really long time
support
ago.
Diet Coke got crossed out for listen to Dave and play football. This is where we write all the hits. You know, with the hope that Simon Cowell will think it was made by an 80-piece orchestra, so... Expensive-sounding music.
I think probably artists like Tom Waits and... I think Arcade Fire have been a really big sort of influence, and I think when I made the first record, I was listening to a lot of Beirut. I think Beirut's, if you're kind of feeling... If I'm feeling a bit, I think Beirut's a good one to listen to because the melodies are so sort of immersive and you can kind of drift off in your, you know, in your imagination for a while. is a really intensely personal thing for me, writing songs. But
I'm always writing and little snippets of things and conversations and stuff, and it all kind of gets collected. But if something's going on in my head and I can't figure it out, usually if I write a song about it, it's a kind of like exorcism of something. It's my way of the world is, I think, for me, like, I feel things in quite an intense way, and the world is almost like hallucinatorily vibrant. And it's like, sometimes it feels like everything's coming at me way too fast. And if I absorb it and then put it into a song, it kind of helps me figure out what's happening. And I'm like, okay, that period of time, this happened.
Sometimes like refining lyrics and trying to make them as good as possible, that can feel a little bit like homework, because you know, pushing yourself as well, you know, sometimes it's very easy for me, especially, to fall into the same patterns of chords, and because it's what comes naturally to your voice, it's what your voice wants to do. So you have to be careful not to be always falling into them, because you keep repeating yourself.
I think some of them are fragments of, a lot of them are, it's all really deeply based in like painting sort of an imaginary picture in someone's head, you know. You're creating an environment or a situation and maybe taking them to, could be a dark place, or it could be, you know, something completely fantastical. And then at the same time, you know, interject it with something random from everyday life. You know, it's mixing it up, I think, making the mundane magical, or vice versa. You know, anything can be, if you sing something with enough passion and emotion, you can turn anything into a song, you know. Singing about kitchen sink, you know, if you put it into a context that people can relate to.
On myself, yeah. When I was a kid, and so desperate to be the right thing, you know, like to be perfect or to get it right, and I'd kind of want to like give myself a hug and be like, you don't have to try so hard, it's gonna be okay, yeah. Or like being you is okay, you know, like you as you are is fine. Coming towards her. Big lesson for me in having time off from performing was when I didn't have the stage or the people to manage that energy and left to my own devices with it, I was just completely unmanageable. I'm quite introverted in a way, so trying to come back into myself after gigs and touring is, I'm still learning, you know, we're on our last tour now. And I'm still trying to like figure out, because there's a side of me that is, yeah, it's like the self-destructive side is almost like running the show when I'm on stage, but there's a place for it. To come down after a tour before, so I would just go on like a massive bender, and that would kind of like flatten me, because you don't actually feel tired when a tour ends. You are so used to running on adrenaline that, and I don't, you know, I wasn't doing that, so I just went straight back in the studio. Wow. It gave me quite a lot of creative freedom though, because no one was expecting me to start working again. My engineer was literally like, what are you doing here? Shouldn't you have a holiday?
Yeah.
I said, no, I've been traveling so much already, like I want to be at home. And maybe it was because of the lack of expectation, or I knew I was doing it just for me. You know, it really felt like when I went back to make this one, it was like how I started making music. Sometimes I feel like throwing my hands up in the air. get up on stage and sing it to other people, and you connect emotionally, that the experience is shared, and that's where the real catharsis comes from, you know, of seeing someone else singing something that felt so personal just to you, to see someone having their own experience is incredibly freeing. If I could like tear pieces of myself off on the stage, I would. Sometimes there's a feeling of wanting to release so much that if I could pull my skin off live on stage, I would do it. You know, there's such a feeling of really wanting, and I think it's almost the energy in the room is everyone also wants to release things at the same time. So as you're performing, you're kind of releasing these things, everyone else's as well, but you also absorb everyone else's feelings. So it's a kind of a, it's almost like you're letting go of it, like everyone's stuff and your own stuff all at once.